Good morning. I'm Carole Galante. I'm the faculty director of the Terner Center for Housing Innovation. And I am here today with Carolina Reid, who is our research advisor, and Elizabeth Kneebone, who is our research director. And I am very excited to be with all of you today. Just a bit of background for those who don't know, the Terner Center for Housing Innovation at UC Berkeley is a relatively new center that was started in 2015 when I left our fair city of Washington, D.C. and moved back to California and started both teaching at UC Berkeley and starting this center. And the focus of the center really is on, as the title indicates, housing innovations, both in practice, and that's in finance, that's in development, and also policy. So doing rigorous research that brings forth policy recommendations, practice recommendations. We are not shy about giving opinions when we think that the evidence supports going in a certain direction. So I am delighted today to have you hear from both Elizabeth and Carolina about some new work that they have both been doing. So you're getting essentially a sneak preview of some unpublished work. And partly we're doing this because we also want to talk about the policy implications of this work, which I will lead at the conclusion of their presentation. And I am very interested in hearing from all of you your ideas, whether it's here in this session or in the other sessions, the implications of some of the work that you're about to hear today. So we're going to start with Elizabeth. Mm-hmm.
Good morning. My time this morning, I want to spend a bit of that time sharing with you some work that we're doing, as this title would suggest, exploring the connection between housing and access to opportunity. And I feel like we could have, like, we product placed Lisa before us to set this up, because it is the perfect follow-on to that wonderful and rich history that you just laid out, or rather, you did a wonderful job laying out a very complicated history in terms of how housing shapes access to opportunity across our major metropolitan markets. And we're interested in this both on the ownership side and the rental side. And you know, that connection between housing and opportunity, it really is a long-standing one. It's very much a part of the way we think about housing in the U.S. We can look at decades of housing policy around ownership, expanding access to ownership, increasing the pool of people who have access to ownership, because there is a recognition that it's a stabilizing force, but it's also a pathway to building assets and wealth. There's opportunity there for wealth building. Increasingly, we've seen this connection between rental housing and opportunity, as decades of research show us the benefits of giving access to opportunity to low-income families in particular, to lower poverty neighborhoods, places that offer better schools and better health options and food options and access to just more opportunity-rich environments, that has long and positive impacts for children and their families. But increasingly, even as that awareness has grown and the prominence of that goal has grown from a policy and market perspective, it's gotten harder to do. It's gotten harder to achieve in a lot of markets across the country. And there are a lot of reasons that we can talk about that are driving that difficulty, especially at the bottom rung. If we think about the sort of entry-level first-time home buyers or lower-income renting families who are trying to find those more opportunity-rich neighborhoods, those entry-level rungs are getting further out of reach for those populations. Some of that's demand side. You know, we have some markets who've just been growing, a lot of Sunbelt, like booming metros, where you just have a lot more people and jobs looking for housing. Some of this is about wages. You know, in some markets, they're spiking. You know, you have Silicon Valley and Seattle seeing really big wage growth that's pushing prices up. Or they're not growing enough. So in weaker markets, where it's just harder and harder to make ends meet and to access home ownership or even opportunity-rich rental options. There's access to credit, which Lisa talked about in depth, and Carolina is going to delve into more, particularly post-recession and how that affects access. What I'm going to talk about today is the supply side piece of this puzzle, about how supply makes a difference, partly in terms of just how much there is, but also where and what kind of supply we're building, and how that maps onto local level access. For one, just nationally, we know we're not producing enough housing to keep pace with the houses, the households who are looking for housing, particularly in the post-recession period. We're now falling short of that one-to-one replacement. And in reality, we need more than a one-to-one replacement of housing units to new households because we have stock going offline too. So we're really seeing a tightening and a gap in terms of just production levels nationally. And that's trickling through on both the ownership and the rental sides to affect these issues of access. So if we start with ownership, we can see, I think, it's probably a familiar curve to a lot of people now, just inventory, what's on the market. That dotted line is like the 6-month mark, which we can think about the sort of equilibrium of the market. Above that, it's a buyer's market. Below that, it's a seller's market. And we've fallen well below that, particularly in the post-recession period. We've seen a real tightening of just what's available and how quickly housing stock is moving in inventory. And when we break this out by price tiers, it's just top tier, middle tier, bottom tier prices of homes, we see that the bottom tier is getting hit particularly hard. They are all feeling it. We're feeling a crunch, especially in high-cost markets across tiers. But where we start to see a bit of a stabilization in middle tier and top tier inventory, that red line is still trending downward. And in more recent data, we're seeing it's getting even tighter at that sort of entry-level tier of home. And we're seeing that reflected in prices, not surprisingly. As we're seeing that tightening, prices are going up. So what it even means to be a bottom tier home is going up. 2/3 of our major metro areas have seen prices increase. The ones in the darkest blue by 50% or even double over the course of the 2000s, since 2000. And actually, if we narrowed this time frame, even some of the red places in the middle of the country are now starting to flip blue in terms of seeing price appreciation at that bottom tier because that tightening is trickling through a lot of different kinds of markets. When we take a closer look at what's going on in high-cost markets, it feels strange to even be calling these are bottom-tier homes, but entry-level may not be the right way to call it. When you see that in San Jose, that's almost $800,000 for the typical bottom-tier home. In California in particular, is home to a lot of high-cost markets. Things like San Jose, San Francisco, Sacramento have seen that typical bottom-tier home price grow by 2/3. In LA, it doubled over the course of the 2000s. So again, if we think about that as the bottom rung on the ladder, it is increasingly out of reach, not just of low-income families, but of moderate and middle-income households too. And so what that means is that who is buying homes is shifting over time. If you look at recent home buyers now compared to recent home buyers at the start of the 2000s, what we see is now recent home buyers tend to be higher income than they were in the past. They're whiter, they're older, and they're more educated. So we're seeing a real shift in who is even that sort of new home buyer. And in 2000, recent home buyers looked a lot like all home buyers. In 2016, again, we saw the shift to higher income, wider, more educated households. So we're shifting the housing ownership market over time as it becomes increasingly hard to enter that market. What that means is if you're shut out of home buying, there's a lot more pressure on the rental market. And that's happening up and down the sort of income spectrum. But what that means is when you're feeling that kind of pressure, that trickles down to really constrained options and choices at the bottom of the income distribution. So low-income households, people of color, people who could best benefit from this access to opportunity, according to all the research that we have, are also the most constrained and probably facing the biggest challenges to get into those higher opportunity neighborhoods. So let's explore that part of the market a little bit more and how supply makes a difference there too, how the local underlying conditions in the market affect where and who has access to these neighborhoods. First, what are we building when we are building? Again, this may not be surprising, although I found the numbers pretty stark when you actually lay it out like this, that yes, in recent years, we have seen a spike in the production of multifamily units that have 50 units or more. They grew by more than half over this time period. And here we're presenting from 1990 through the most recent 2012 to 2016 period. But even with that more than half, that growth, it's a drop in the bucket compared to single family, which is on the left. That is the biggest part of the market, and it's where the biggest piece of the growth has continued to be, even in recent years. And the fact that we are a single family housing unit nation, that is the bulk of our production, that shapes what our neighborhoods look like. It shapes where we're building, and again, affects the sort of underlying landscape of opportunity in these metro areas. So to understand how this changes the way our neighborhoods look or affects the way our neighborhoods look, we parse out our tracks within the census tracks within the 100 largest metro areas based on, you know, the housing stock, the mix of what's available in the neighborhood. And the sorting factor here is the share of single family homes that make up the stock in the neighborhood. So on the far right, we're having what we have the single, what we're calling single family neighborhoods. That means 90% or more of the housing stock are single family homes. The next one over is predominantly single family, so 70 to 90% of housing stock is single family homes. Then we have more mixed housing stock, so there's still a significant share of single family homes between 30 and 70, but you see a lot more multifamily coming into the mix. And then on the far left here, we're calling majority multifamily neighborhoods, only 30% or less of the stock is single family. So this is really where we see a lot more of the sort of high rise rentals and more dense sort of forms of development. So if we spread our neighborhoods out across these categories and draw the line in the middle of this graph, half of neighborhoods in 1990 were predominantly single family or single family. Then if we overlay what we just saw about production on top of this, you see total net change in units. We'd added the most in the sort of mixed housing stock and predominantly single family neighborhoods, but when you look at the type of production within those neighborhoods that's driving the uptick, it is single family homes. That lower gray bar, the biggest chunk of each of those are still single family homes. So even if you're in a more mixed neighborhood, single family homes were driving your production, unless you were in this far left column, which is again where we see that uptick in the 50 unit plus buildings. And neighborhoods didn't really change much over time with all this growth. That the form of the neighborhood, most neighborhoods stayed the same kind of type they started in 1990. But as a result of this drive of single family housing productions, when neighborhoods did tip, they tipped into the most single family category. So that 90% plus of stock being single family. So this all has implications for, again, where opportunity is, but also where rental opportunity is and just access into the housing market. If you lay these sort of neighborhood types side by side and look at characteristics of these neighborhoods, one thing I think that is not surprising is that these multifamily neighborhoods are densest. They tend to be denser on average. They're also more centralized. They're closer to downtown. They're more centrally located. As you move right across that chart to the single family category, you get farther away and less dense. You also see the home values do a bit of a U here. The highest home values are in those multifamily neighborhoods, then it dips as you move to more mixed until it peaks up again in the single family neighborhoods on the far right. And we think about that, you know, that tells me a couple things. The multifamily neighborhood in particular tells me a couple things, that there is a lot of opportunity in some of these neighborhoods. Some of these are really wealthy areas with a lot of luxury condos. They may be very close to jobs and to work, and those are opportunity areas. But they're also, if you look to the bottom line, cheek by jowl with areas of concentrated poverty, that on average, in fact, these multifamily neighborhoods have almost a 30% poverty rate. So even within that category, there's opportunity and then there's concentrated distress. And where the rental market is, especially for low-income renters, is often not in the latter or former category, it's more often in the latter. So as you move away, though, and as we follow that poverty trend across the categories, you see poverty does drop the more you get into the predominantly single family neighborhoods. It also, those neighborhoods get much whiter, much less diverse, and the rental opportunities also drop off as you move away from that more dense multifamily category. And if we focus in on that, just where are rental opportunities, because there is so much more demand for that type of housing stock now, or that option of housing. Perhaps not surprisingly, we see just total number of units where rental units are. Most of those are in multifamily or mixed, where we have more multifamily options, so those left two categories. Far fewer options in the predominantly single family and single family neighborhoods. And correspondingly, what it costs to rent in these neighborhoods shifts as well. So those single family neighborhoods with the lowest levels of poverty and often other very strong indicators of access to opportunity also are the most expensive, and you have the fewest options. So again, if we think about that low-income segment of the population looking for rental, what this also tells me is competing in the open market is not really an option for more and more of these families. Subsidies are increasingly important as we think about how to overlay on those local dynamics to increase options available to families. So we can look at this in a number of ways. What I'm going to focus on today is low-income housing tax credits, where those units have been produced, and overlay that on the dynamics we've just been looking at. So this is total units of LIHTC projects produced since 1990, so new construction LIHTC since 1990, across these neighborhood categories. And your gut would probably tell you before I showed you the slide that most of those units have been in multifamily and in the mixed housing stock types of neighborhoods. Far fewer have been produced in these predominantly single-family or single-family neighborhoods. I should also back up and say on top of this, 86% of tracts in our major metros don't have any LIHTC. So this is, you know, a very constrained set of tracts already that we're talking about. And within that pool of tracts that have subsidy, it really skews disproportionately towards multifamily and multifamily or in mixed housing stock. Again, this is just a reminder, that's the opposite direction of where we've seen production go and where we're actually building houses in a lot of these regions. Again, that has implications for these increasing number of states and localities who are trying to use that credit to increase access to opportunity. What we see overall, by there are a lot of indicators of opportunity, but again, if we just take one and looking at poverty rates overall, we can see for just on the left, something we've heard about a lot, that LIHTC units often end up in higher poverty rate areas than places that don't have LIHTC. But when you parse that out by neighborhood type, you can see that the places that were able to build LIHTC properties in predominantly single-family and single-family neighborhoods did actually increase the access to lower poverty neighborhoods for the families living in those units. The thing is, it's just with all these ground conditions, with the way that we build and zone and have shaped housing production over time, it means the people on the right end of that are really fighting an uphill battle to actually achieve those goals of increasing options and penetration into those types of neighborhoods. So that's, again, the big takeaway of all of it. I know there's a lot of data here, but I think the big takeaway is just as we think about these policy goals of how to use housing as an access to opportunity or pathway to economic security and stability, supply has to be a part of that discussion because it is very much a part of the constraints that are keeping us from meeting those goals for our most vulnerable and marginalized populations. And yet, even as we see that and recognize that, it also means that just supply, where we put our subsidies or where we incentivize the location of subsidies, how we deal with access to credit, which Carolina is going to talk about, super important and critical tools, but it's not going to move the needle the way we want to see it until we address supply and underlying conditions of how we're building our metropolitan areas. So with that, I will turn the discussion over to Carolina, and I look forward to the discussion afterward.
So thank you. And I feel like what I'm going to try and do is actually build on both Lisa and Elizabeth's presentation to talk about how access to credit has changed since the financial crisis, since the foreclosure crisis, with a specific focus on how lending to Black and Hispanic households has changed. And rather than just focusing on the individuals, trying to understand what this means for neighborhoods and access to opportunity. So if we think about sort of changing lending patterns, that influences people's well-being, but it also influences neighborhood well-being. And I feel like this question of lending recovery, and particularly with a focus on Blacks and Hispanics, is particularly important given the foreclosure crisis and who it affected. And Lisa already pointed to this, but overall, the foreclosure crisis had a disparate impact on Black and Hispanic households. We estimate that between that for households, Black and Hispanic households who bought a home between 2004 and 2008, a quarter of them lost their homes to foreclosure. So we had a significant expansion of credit and then a significant sort of impact and on communities of color. And we know that since the financial crisis, there has been a significant contraction in credit. So this graph sort of takes 2004 as a baseline of lending volumes and looks at how lending volumes to different demographic groups has changed over time. So as you can see, we actually aren't back to 2004 lending levels for any demographic group, though we can see that after 2013, we do see an improvement in lending volumes or a recovery in lending volumes. But lending volumes for African Americans and Blacks has considerably less than for the other demographic groups. And in fact, they are still sort of 40% below where they were in 2004. So my question in this research paper is, what does this mean for neighborhoods? And while mortgage access credit isn't the only kind of credit and only kind of lending that matters for neighborhoods, the very foundations of community development and the very foundations of the Community Reinvestment Act are around the idea that credit is really vital to neighborhood health. I really appreciated how you were talking about these civil rights laws, and I feel like CRA can be part of that, right? It doesn't incorporate race specifically in its guidelines and its regulations, but CRA is vital to our understanding and our access to credit and our access to sort of loans for both affordable rental housing but also home ownership in these communities. And certainly is trying to undo this legacy of redlining that is still so pervasive today and so determinant of residential segregation. So the research question I'm asking is, what has the recovery looked like? And very simply, who has benefited from this recovery and what neighborhoods have benefited from this recovery? And I'm not gonna focus too much on the methodology in this presentation, but just to give you a quick overview of what I did, I took all neighborhoods in the United States, I looked at their lending patterns during the boom, the crisis, and the recovery, and I did cluster analysis to understand if we could identify neighborhood typologies. Are there certain kinds of neighborhoods that sort of cluster together that can give us a picture of how access to loans, lending is shaping neighborhood recovery? And then I do a series of models to try and assess what is the relationship between these different neighborhood clusters and various factors. And so I'm just gonna present the sort of highlight findings from that. So the analysis identifies five different clusters, and I'm gonna take a minute here to talk through all different five clusters. The first cluster all the way on your left is what I'm calling distressed neighborhoods. These are neighborhoods that have seen no recovery in lending. These are neighborhoods where I can't even analyze the impacts of lending on the community because there are zero loans in the recovery. These are areas that are truly distressed and are characterized by extremely high rates of poverty, extremely high rates of abandoned and vacant properties, and that are in desperate need of sort of classic community development to restart markets, to provide access to opportunity in place, to think about how do we support households through employment, workforce development, affordable housing subsidies. The second neighborhood cluster that emerges is what I'm calling majority-minority neighborhoods. These have seen almost no recovery in lending since the crisis. You can see that the volume of loans since the depth of the crisis is really only about sort of 2% higher than that sort of down thing, or down point, right? The vast majority of loans in these neighborhoods, over 80%, go to Blacks and Hispanics. The next neighborhood cluster, which I'm calling changing neighborhoods, I'd love to have you guys help me with a better name for this, because it's not very evocative. But these are neighborhoods that have rapidly changed since the crisis. And in fact, these are the neighborhoods that used to be predominantly neighborhoods where we saw a good volume of lending to Black and Hispanic households. And since the crisis, the shift in lending has gone almost entirely to white and Asian households. So these were the neighborhoods that were really hard hit by the foreclosure crisis, and in the aftermath and during the recovery, the lending has shifted demographically to whole new groups. And I'm gonna talk about the implications of that in just a second. The fourth bucket is what I call integrated neighborhoods. And these are, to me, almost like the holy grail, and I'm still trying to understand what these neighborhoods are, but these are neighborhoods where the share of lending to the different demographic groups actually almost identically aligns with the population demographics. So about 30 to 40% of loans are going to blacks and Hispanics. That's about their representation in the US population. And there's a really nice mix of incomes in these neighborhoods, a really nice mix of races. There's also a really nice mix of housing types, as to Elizabeth's presentation, and solid indicators of opportunity, right? Good schools, not too high rates of poverty. So trying to understand better, are there certain policies that have made these neighborhoods what they are? The fifth cluster is what I call majority white neighborhoods. This is where the vast majority of lending, about 97%, goes only to white households. So if we remember that the overall population of minorities in this country is around 35% or so, these are neighborhoods that are still exclusively white. Now, the most striking thing for me in this research project, so I run my cluster analysis, right? I throw it into this program, I say run, and it spits out my results. Anybody notice how many census tracts fall in this predominantly white neighborhoods? It's about 52,000 neighborhoods. There's about 70,000 neighborhoods in this country, census tracts. So 50,000 out of our 70,000 census tracts in the United States, almost all the lending in those places is only going to white households. That is a huge tragedy, given that 50 years after the Fair Housing Act, we still do not have any sort of sense of equality in lending. The other thing is that this lending pattern is hugely consistent over time. So I thought there would be a chance that during the boom, during the subprime boom, we would see more lendings to blacks and Hispanics in these majority white neighborhoods, the ones all the way on the left there. And in fact, it's not really true. Right? These lending patterns of what neighborhoods get loans to what type of demographic groups is persistent and pretty sort of hard to change, with the exception of these changing neighborhoods, where you can see across the boom, crisis, and recovery a significant decrease in the share of lending that is going to blacks and Hispanics. So this is the share of lending that goes to blacks and Hispanics. So you can see in the majority minority neighborhoods a really high concentration of lending to blacks and Hispanics, and then in the majority white a very low concentration, and then this sort of changing neighborhoods cluster. All right, so this paper isn't about FHA, but when you work with Carole, it's hard not to talk at least one slide about FHA. So I looked and see what is the role of FHA in this, and in fact, if we didn't have FHA, we would have seen a much larger contraction of lending overall, and the neighborhoods that would have been most affected would have been these majority-minority neighborhoods, as well as lendings to blacks and Hispanics, right? FHA has played a fundamental role in ensuring that the recovery hasn't only gone to white and Asian households, but despite these sort of inequalities, and over half of loans in both these majority-minority neighborhoods and to blacks and Hispanics are being made by FHA or FHA loans. Okay, so what are the implications of this? So there are several implications. I'm going to focus on two here. The first is that these changing neighborhoods are exactly the neighborhoods that are experiencing gentrification and displacement of black and Hispanic households. So in my models, and it depends a little bit on the model specification, I find that these changing neighborhoods where we've seen the greatest decrease in mortgage loans to blacks and Hispanics are associated with a 2.5 or 3 times greater odds that that neighborhood is experiencing gentrification and turnover. This is conditional on whether or not the neighborhoods are in one of these high, tight supply markets that Elizabeth was talking about. So it's not universal across the country. It's in these tight housing markets where supply hasn't kept up with demand that we see this confluence of gentrification and a shift in lending patterns in terms of who is getting loans. The second is that in these majority-minority neighborhoods where we still see the vast majority of blacks and Hispanics being able to buy a home, there is continued distress and continuing and worsening poverty in these neighborhoods and economic decline. And so again, for community development, this has significant implications, particularly around making sure that these homeowners don't get trapped in poverty, right? And that they benefit from the aspects of homeownership that really matter, including stability, access to educational opportunity, and access to wealth building. I just wanted to show one map. It's hard with a national audience like here to show what is happening in all these different cities and what I mean about these different neighborhoods. But I thought I'd show at least a picture of DC to show you how these neighborhood clusters play out in a metropolitan area. So the areas in blue are what I call these majority white neighborhoods. Those are all the neighborhoods where only about 2% of loans at any one time go to blacks and Hispanics. The gray areas, and you can see, this is like the redlining maps that Lisa was showing earlier, the segregation maps, right? You can see it still so clearly in these lending patterns that those neighborhoods on the right in the gray are the ones that are still, most of the loans in those neighborhoods are going to blacks and Hispanics. It is those yellow neighborhoods in the middle that are shifting. And those are the areas where yesterday, as I was walking through DC by my hotel there by 16th and 10th, right, that are all turning and all turning yellow. All right, this has implications as well in terms of who's benefiting from the recovery for wealth. And the house price recovery has been fastest in these changing or gentrifying neighborhoods. And that means that for all of these households who have been able to get in the recovery, they're the ones who are benefiting from the house price recovery, as opposed to the black and Hispanic homeowners that were there before this crisis and recovery. And back of the envelope estimates that we've done suggest that if we had just kept in those neighborhoods extending credits to blacks and Hispanics at the same rate as we did in 2004, so prior to the boom, they would have accumulated more than $13 billion more in wealth. So this is a transfer of $13 billion of wealth from the black and Hispanic community through sort of our inability to sort of access or extend credit over this recovery time period. So I'm going to conclude the importance of CRA here. It's no less important than 40 years ago. The Fair Housing Act is no less important than 50 years ago. Right? These are enduring problems that we need to confront as people who care about community development and lending. And just on a caveat, it's really hard to disentangle cause and effect, right? I don't know what comes first. I don't know if it's supply, if it's demand in these neighborhoods. It's really hard to sort of assess the directions of causality. But certainly, if I can leave you with one conclusion, is that this foreclosure crisis is having an enduring effect on communities and should be affecting our community development strategies and ensuring that we sort of bring all these neighborhoods up to being neighborhoods of opportunity, right? We don't want to just focus on moving people around. We really want to focus on improving place. And that just continued attention to how access to credit is really still being influenced by race and ethnicity. Because otherwise, access to opportunity and the wealth gap is just going to become increasingly large. Thank you.
Thank you both. I have the unenviable task of following all this terrific research and saying, what do we do about this? trying to come up with the good policy solutions that can really help move the dial on opportunity across all these different issues that you've just heard about, both from Lisa's presentation and Elizabeth's and Carolina's. And so I'm gonna take a crack at a couple of emerging ideas that we have, but I really do want to leave some time to hear some thoughts from all of you. And I will say that the biggest takeaway, the biggest aha to me after absorbing some of this work is just that we really have to have, across a number of planes, policy solutions that are both and strategies or more integrated strategies across a number of different planes. So let me just talk about four of those planes and then give some examples of some policy prescriptions that are in my head that may not be particularly good ideas, I'm not sure yet, but you know, of how we really tackle these issues. So the four planes, as I've thought about it, are we need more coordinated and thoughtful integration across geographic planes, so federal, state, regional, local, neighborhood. We know that one size doesn't fit all, but we've got to have an integration of policies coming from the federal government and then up from the neighborhood level and try to coordinate them in the places, and I'll get to some thoughts on that. The second is, and we've probably heard this both from Elizabeth and Carolina already, but it's about supply and access, that either one is not sufficient to getting us to opportunity. So we can have much better access, we can have much better programs, much better financing, but without dealing with the supply and the geographical implications of that supply and and the types of supply that's being produced, we're not going to get there. So we need coordinated action across those two planes. The other, which I think comes out in both of their presentations, is we really need to be thinking about a continuum on the income spectrum in a way that I think we just don't do. And that is, we're going to continue to have this barbell effect on race. We're going to continue to have a barbell effect on incomes in terms of opportunities unless we start thinking about this missing middle much more seriously from a policy perspective than I think collectively we all have been doing, both private sector as well as various governmental policies. And then the last, and it really goes to, and I'll talk some more about this, to some of Carolina's last point, I can remember when Sean Donovan and I first got to HUD in 2009, we were all about talking about a balanced housing policy, that we needed more focus on rental, that we'd had all this focus on home ownership, and we needed a more balanced federal housing policy. And I think that's still true. I do think that balance, particularly depending on the geography and the neighborhoods and opportunities, we really need to be thinking on a sub-market way on the ownership side to deal with some of our displacement and gentrification issues. So those are the four planes that I've been thinking about and needing to have more integration. So let me give you a couple of policy ideas across some of those planes. So on the first one of geography and coordination of policies at the federal through the neighborhood level, I want to use the example that Elizabeth started with on the low-income housing tax credit program. So in California, the state tax credit committee started a major effort to map opportunity and to create incentives and requirements for more of the LIHTC projects going to high resource neighborhoods and fewer going to low resource neighborhoods. And I would say that their first crack at coming up with this methodology had some challenges that these two in particular spent a lot of time helping craft to get right. But one of the big ahas for us when we looked at the incentives to get LIHTC properties into high resource, high opportunity neighborhoods was that many of these places that were now designated as high opportunity, high resource had no multifamily zoning. Okay? So you're not going to get any LIHTC properties in those, depending on which category you're talking about here, in those majority single-family white neighborhoods, unless you do something at the state, regional, local level that either mandates or incentivizes that local governments and neighborhoods each have a certain amount of multifamily zoning. Now, we can also change the LIHTC program to be, you know, doing more what Cleveland Housing Network does and trying to do more in the single family scattered site, and I'm not suggesting that isn't an opportunity as well, but I do think tying at the state level, say transportation dollars or infrastructure dollars that these communities want. So not just housing dollars, because some of these communities, frankly, they don't really care and maybe don't want the LIHTC dollars, right? But let's tie other resources that these communities want to that you must have certain amount of designated multifamily property in your community. And that could be in the downtown areas, you know, that are more appropriate for multifamily perhaps than, you know, we're not talking about tearing down very expensive single family homes that are valuable to create multifamily zoning, but there are ways along commercial corridors, et cetera. So that's an example of we've got to have an integrated geography, geographical thought process if we want to get to good outcomes. On the supply access to credit plane, I'll kind of use the continuum example here of income as well. I think one of our policy prescriptions needs to be thinking about neighborhoods that are predominantly single-family zoned and opening up those zoning categories to not multifamily 50-unit buildings, but more of this missing middle typology of, I'm not talking about income here, I'm talking about physical typology of density. So more accessory dwelling units in the single family neighborhoods and opening up the opportunities for that. And then tying some financing incentives to that. So giving homeowners who live in these communities better access to financing. And I think Fannie Mae, for example, has started to open this up a little bit, but there's a long way to go. Trying to coordinate opening up that single family zoning and allowing duplexes and quads on some of these lots in some of these neighborhoods, and then tying some financial incentives, targeting some financial incentives to enabling those homeowners and small boutique developers to actually be able to produce that, which is there's a big gap, talk about a barbell effect, there's a big gap between the flippers who come in and to a neighborhood and buy and rehab and flip, and you know the major single-family home builders, and we need an industry that can focus on this missing middle. So that's another example. I think some of those special incentives. I go back to the FHA and some of the work we did there on back to work and looking at manually underwriting people who are coming out of the foreclosure crisis, getting them back into an FHA loan sooner. You can target some of those special products. The housing counseling HAWC program that I tried to implement that didn't go anywhere. But you know, trying to have more incentives. Why not have a lower mortgage insurance premium in FHA for certain product types for at a price point? So at entry level price points, let's lower the premium. Let's not lower it everywhere, maybe. Let's lower the premium in a targeted way. So to create better access tools matched with the inventory that we need in creating an incentive to do both. And then, you know, I would just really want to end on focusing on this changing neighborhood dynamic. And I would say we are living this from a policy perspective in the Bay Area with like visceral intensity, watching neighborhoods change. And Carolina's and Elizabeth's work both show this so dramatically. The displacement through the foreclosure crisis in particular, but again, not, you know, we can't point all this to causal relationships, but the foreclosure crisis, the pressure on the rental stock at a time when the supply is not keeping up, all of those things together have put such pressure on neighborhoods that were once primarily high poverty, lower income, black and Hispanic people, and are changing so rapidly we can't even capture the information. And yet we have some folks in the Bay Area who think the solution to that is no new market rate construction in those neighborhoods. That, you know, let's just put rent control on everything and that will solve our problems. And I don't think that will not only not solve all problems, it will, you know, make those pressures worse in many ways. So yet we have an urgent problem of displacement. And I think we have overlooked that one of the important solutions here is actually to create much better access and solutions, some of which I just mentioned, targeted to those neighborhoods for home ownership. If we have good mortgage product attached to the right kind of new supply and existing supply, there's nothing that will inoculate these communities that are under stress of displacement more than, you know, creating better opportunities in those neighborhoods through home ownership. Now, that's not, again, back to the balance of rental and rental and home ownership. I don't think that's the only solution. I think there's plenty of rental housing strategies in those communities that we need to look at, including some I think that you'll be talking about later today, which is creating incentives to take the remaining naturally occurring affordable housing in these neighborhoods, which is rapidly not naturally occurring affordable anymore because, you know, we have massive, you know, acquisition of these properties that, again, I don't have the data on this, but I think a lot of the dramatic rent increases happen when you have a new investor come in and buy property in these rapidly changing neighborhoods, and they're buying it for a value that's based on its future market rent potential, which is growing because of the lack of supply significantly every day. And so they buy it at a high price. They need to get high rents in order to justify that high price. And so they are, displacing everybody who lives there with high rent increases and evictions. And the population is getting changed over. So really looking at a much greater proportion of whatever subsidy dollars we have and financial incentives we have available and creating new ones to access that housing stock and arrest that that flip to the high market rate rentals. And I'm not necessarily suggesting they all go and become low-income housing tax credit properties. Like, you know, let's just do some minimal rehab. Let's not spend tons and tons of money that needs to be recouped, but let's just arrest the need to increase those rents so dramatically. And I think there's lots of solutions there that we ought to be focused on as a lending and policy community. So I'm going to stop there. I could keep riffing on lots of early emerging ideas I have, but I'd love to stop and open it up and both for questions on the research that you heard, as well as, you know, comments or thoughts you have about where we should be taking this. So I see a couple right here.
We were also asked that you introduce yourself before you speak.
Sure. Clark Ziegler from the Massachusetts Housing Partnership. I'm wondering for any of you to answer, how do we broaden the political constituency for a thoughtful supply strategy? Because I think we have a lot of the same characteristics in Massachusetts that you have in California. And all the arguments around supply tend to be around sort of the economic imperative about jobs and the economy, not about racial equity, not about income inequality. And I think the politics, the people who are most adversely affected by the lack of supply in a lot of cases are anti-development, anti-developer, want, you know, only affordable housing or no development. How do we kind of shift those, that political dynamic? Because I think the people who could benefit the most from additional supply in a thoughtful way aren't necessarily at the table advocating for it.
Well, I'll give you one thought, and I'd love to hear if you guys have thoughts on this. I think it goes to the broadening to the missing middle from an income perspective. I think we have to join, I think the affordable housing advocates, so to speak, have to join with the YIMBYs. I don't know how active your YIMBY movement is, but we have a real YIMBY movement in California that's making an impact. They sometimes are a bit tone deaf relative to some of the racial implications, but I think there can be, and there are some groups that are very thoughtful about this. There's a group in Oakland called the Tech Equity Collaborative that, you know, is very much thinking about how do you share the goal from kind of your millennial folks who want to live in cities, who have income, who frankly feel guilty in many ways about moving into communities that they may have displaced somebody. I mean, they really do, but they need a place to live that they can afford as well, right? So I think there's a marrying of that constituency group that could be had in a thoughtful way. And it's starting to emerge a little organically, at least in some places. You guys have thoughts on that? I think it's a great question.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned tech equity. You also have Silicon Valley at home in the Bay Area. And I think like the bigger picture takeaway of those groups is broadening the stakeholders that are part of it. And it's a lot of, I mean, that's, you wish there was a silver bullet. It's a lot of personal relationship building so that they have that network in place. So when the projects come up, you've already got the sort of ground game going. And it's, you know, we've seen the same thing, like sort of pilots of this in Chicago as well. Like, can we get the business community in? Who are the key sort of playmakers that aren't typically at the affordable housing table that could be brought over because they see the impact on jobs, on their workforce? And that the, what I think is interesting about these groups and what's going on in Chicago is the idea of, does it have to be quick, let's do this right now because the project is right in front of us? Or can you kind of get that coalition on board so they're ready to motivate when you see opportunities coming up? But it is just a lot of personal, getting the right people to talk to each other building that we've seen.
I would just say too that the supply conversation also has to go to these other neighborhoods that have been so exclusionary over time, right? Like there is no reason not to feel like you are being bombarded by new market rate luxury condos when those are only going in neighborhoods that used to be largely minority and, you know, bastions of affordability and home ownership. So I feel like, you know, we have to continue to push on those 70,000 census or those 50,000 census tracts who are exclusionary in every sense of the word.
Goes back to the both and. there's lots of hands. Who has the mic? Okay.
Hi.
It's on.
Stuart Boesky from Pembroke Capital Management. We see in the major markets, San Francisco, New York, Los Angeles, tax credit deals, new construction that are being built, and the cost is exorbitant, $500,000, $600,000, $700,000 a unit. Not only is that maybe, or more, not only maybe is that not the best use of capital, it probably reflects poorly on the program ultimately. It subjects the program to some scrutiny, I would guess. It would seem to me intuitively that preservation of affordable housing in those markets could be far less expensive. But there doesn't seem to be any program that anyone's offering. And has anyone done a cost-benefit analysis of what, you know, why did you build 200 units at 700,000 apiece? We could have saved 800 units of perfectly serviceable, affordable housing for less money. Has anyone done that work, and has anyone really thought about a real preservation program?
So we're working on that right now. So we're working on trying to both figure out what are the drivers of the costs of LIHTC, right? Like, why are these units costing 700,000 apiece? But then also recognizing, I don't know the numbers quite off the top of my head, but we built something like 14,000 LIHTC units in the last 6 years in San Francisco, Oakland, and San Mateo, which is a lot, right? That's a healthy LIHTC production, and we lost about $120,000 of units that we're renting at below $1,200 a month, which is about the LIHTC unit. So we have to develop a stronger preservation strategy and funding. San Francisco has a small sites acquisition program that's trying to do that. Oakland's talking about similarly using local funding, but this is an opportunity for federal funding as well, because there's more markets where this is a problem.
I'm also gonna, I come from a background of having run, you know, one of the largest LIHTC producers in California. And I have to say I'm a little annoyed with all my compatriots, former compatriots out there, because the community, the LIHTC community, has a model, and they make development fees from that model. And they get nice, shiny new buildings from that model. They're easier to manage, blah, 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 right? They have a business model that works, and they're very busy at it, right? There's lots of work to do. And so they don't feel incentive to shift and try to deal with some of these messy acquisition rehabs, more risk. And neither the local government subsidy nor the, at least in California, the state policies encourage it. And I guess the last thing I'll say is we do still need the new supply, right? So a part of, I think, the answer is not to just take it all and put it in preservation, although I think you could change the proportion. But we need to get the cost of production of the new supply down substantially. And there are ways to do that from a policy perspective and a practice perspective, including using more offsite construction, dealing with development fees. There's a number of different things we can and should be doing. And I think as an industry, if the LIHTC industry, financiers, investors, producers, don't get a hold of this, and I hate to be negative, but I think it could be too late. The GAO is coming out with a study on the tax credit program on costs. They have a bunch of sample projects from California. I'm scared to death.
Well, I agree with you 100%. And as you said, you know, the LIHTC business is an enormous business. It has a model, and people don't like to let go of the model. But unless you confront the industry with a alternative model, if you will, based upon actual data that shows number one, there's a tremendous waste of dollars, and it's not really benefiting these communities in the appropriate way. You have to start there, and then you have to suggest another model. And certainly the private sector needs to be incentivized to adopt the model, otherwise it won't work. But you first have to come up with the data to show them how terribly wasteful it is to build 200 units at a million a unit or whatever it is in San Francisco, as opposed to saving 800 or 900 units in a perfectly reasonable and profitable way for the private sector.
Thank you. All right, there's one back here.
Just a quick clarifying question. First, thank you for your research. In terms of looking at mortgages, how did you control for a deal with all cash transactions, particularly in certain neighborhoods? And with regard to the use of the term minorities, are you also looking or including Asians? So when I think about San Francisco, Oakland, and all cash transactions, I don't think it'll be incorporated in your analysis, but I just wanted to confirm.
So that's right. So it's very hard to get local estimates of how many properties are actually transferring by all cash transactions. I control for it in the models in part by looking at shifts in the rental stock, because most of the sort of all cash transactions are from investors who are purchasing those properties for rentals based on research we've done. So I'm trying to control for that, but it's inadequate. I'm hoping to get some new data that will allow me to do that more robustly. So I've struggled with trying to figure out how to deal with the difference between Asians, Blacks, and Hispanics. There are certain segments of the Asian population that are equally disadvantaged when it comes to accessing credit, but their profiles are looking really different in the recovery when you look at Asians in aggregate. You see a very different trend for Asians that is much more parallel to non-Hispanic whites when we sort of have this big Asian category together, and then we see a very different trajectory for Blacks and Hispanics. So that it works better to separate that out, but I'm uncomfortable with that separation. But for example, in San Francisco, there's one neighborhood, Bayview Hunters Point. I don't know how many of you are familiar with it. It's a historically African American neighborhood, had very high rates of homeownership for Blacks and Hispanics, experienced a very high foreclosure rate, and almost every single purchase in that neighborhood since the crisis has gone to Asian households.
Over here.
Hi, does this work? Yes. Mm-hmm. Hi, my name's Cliff Kellogg, and it's one thing and a very serious problem to talk about the markets that we've been discussing, but let me take you to Detroit, where the average single family house median is $39,000 to buy a single family house with a garage and a yard. And the volume of mortgages declined pre-recession was about 6,000 a year. And it reached a low point of about 200 a year just a couple of years ago. It's now climbed back to almost 1,000. So we have a very different market. And I wanted to point out a couple of interesting parts of the analysis we did of the housing market in Detroit may be relevant as you think about how to take your very good analysis to the next step. The first thing was we looked at the reasons for denial in the HMDA data. And we discovered that in Detroit, the largest reason for denial was not credit, but rather insufficient collateral. In other words, the property value didn't support the purchase price, the contract price. And so I think it would be interesting to sort of dive a little deeper to the extent the HMDA data allows it to look at the reasons for denial and how that might affect demand for housing. The second point is that Detroit researchers had done some really extraordinary work on looking at the types of investors who owned and were acquiring property. And at the depths of the recession in Detroit, many of the purchasers were foreign Chinese investors, people who would say, oh, I'm just going to buy a piece of Detroit and hold it until eventually the market comes up. And those investors really had no intention of ever, it seems, improving the property. More recently, the investment pattern shows people who are in the nearby region purchasing more properties in Detroit. So I think that foreshadows that there's a different kind of development opportunity that needs to be factored into the policy analysis, at least for that market right there. The third thing I wanted to say is that I was surprised at how little information there is on who these buyers are, the few buyers that do come into the city of Detroit. If we knew more about what their motivations are, then as a policy and lending community, we could do more to attract more of those buyers or find out who's not coming into the market and make a sort of a counter-cyclical pitch to them. So I think we don't know very much and would do well to know more about the characteristics of the people who are able and interested in buying in a market that would seem by other measures maybe not to be appealing. And the last thing I wanted to say was about your comment on the need for a development community for these small properties. That is, these what we might hope to find as response, not flippers, but people who really are doing a quality job. And how do we assure that there's an economic model that works for them? Because renting would seem to be a much better economic transaction for them when the sales prices are so low.
Thank you. We are now over time by 2 minutes. So I don't know if you have any quick, either of you, quick response to these comments. Otherwise, we'll close it out.
No, super helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll be around. Happy to answer questions later.